Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to Seoul Union Church. Today I am happy to see some new faces. And, as you know that Rachel Han joined us last Sunday and today she is going to have a special music too. So, you know, Rachel Han. We have Simon. Simon is Dolner. He's from Germany. He's traveling in Korea for about 2 weeks and he found us. So we're happy. Simon is with us. You see that handsome man sitting there. And of course, we have Pastor Tim Dilmuth and his family. So, Pastor Tim is here, and his wife Melissa Tim, and then their daughters. They have three children. One is missing. I don't know where he is. But Emily and Amy are here. Emily finished her high school education now, and she'll go to the USA. And Amy is now attending an international school in Hanam, you know Hanam. So we are very happy they are here. Pastor Tim is going to deliver a message from the book of Jeremiah, and I will introduce him before he begins his sermon. Next week we are going to have Reverend Andrew Miller. He is coming from Australia. He is the International Operation Coordinator for Deaf Ministries International in Australia. And this is one of the organizations we support. So he's going to deliver us a testimony, 7 minute testimony next week. So I hope maybe some of you know him, I'm not sure. So please come and have fellowship with him. And next Sunday, I heard that, I don't know if it's going to happen or not, I heard that Changsu is going to sing a very special song. And Rachel is going to play piano for him. Rachel plays piano and violin both. She's very talented. So I'm very excited. I wish tomorrow is a Sunday, next Sunday. So we'll see. Our website, SeoulUnionChurch.org, is now up and running, so you can check. We will regularly upload our news and activities. There are many Facebooks. I don't know why they made it five or six Facebooks in the past. We are trying to clean them up too. They are not in usable situation now, but we are working hard. And the Youngie and the Seogwon worked very hard for the website and the one Facebook. Now we are working on the other Facebook. So someday we will be able to use our Facebooks. All right. Prayer request is that pray for our members who are traveling overseas. I'm sure there are many more, but I have some names here. Jack and Eddie Moon and Nahum Kim, John Lee and Youngie Lee and her husband. Also pray for Peter Kim's recovery from his surgery. Maybe Peter will be here next Sunday, but I think he is doing much better now. All right. Let's focus on the face of our God, Yahweh the Almighty. Call to worship. It's on the bulletin. Okay, I give you thanks, O Lord, with all my heart. I will sing your praises before the gods.
We praise your name for your unfailing love and thankfulness, for your promises are kept by the Lord of your name.
As soon as I pray, you answer me. You encourage me by giving me strength.
Though I am surrounded by troubles, you will return to me from the anger of my hands.
You reach out your hand, and the power of your right hand saves me.
The Lord will work out his plans for my life, for your faithful love, O Lord, endures forever. Don't abandon me, for you hate me.
I know that the Lord secures justice for the poor and upholds the cause of the needy.
Surely the righteous will praise your name, and the upright will live in your presence.
Let us stand and sing two songs, all hail the power of Jesus' name, and he knows my name.
You no doubt are familiar with the first hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, but I saw the second verse when I was printing this out, and I don't think I've ever sung the second verse, and I didn't know it. So, crown him, ye martyrs of your God, who from his altar call, extol the stem of Jesse's rod, and crown him Lord of all. So when we get to the second verse, that may be new for you all, but I hope you can join in with that as well.
Thank you.
Please be seated. There's only one violin, but the one violin adding the piano. How wonderful. Chang Soo Kim is going to lead us in prayer and the Lord's Prayer.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us together into your presence this morning. Father, we thank you that you love us and protect us from all dangers and evil spirits. We confess that too often our hectic agendas have pushed you aside as we try to do our jobs. We pray that nothing may separate us from you, and that you would protect us from our own careless thoughts, words, and actions. Please keep us from being distracted by our wants, our desires, our thoughts on how things should be. Father, help us to walk by your word and not by our feelings. Help us to remember what a blessing it is to walk with you, and thank you for strengthening our journey with you. Father, we ask that you would give us wisdom, strength, and discernment to overcome challenges and difficulties that we face in our day-to-day lives. We lift up all of those whose lives have been touched and affected by tragedy, economic crisis, health and family issues, whether by accident or deliberate act, and especially those that are persecuted for their faith. Lead them through this darkness into your arms. We pray that you would encourage them and fill each heart with love, peace, and hope. Father, we commemorated the Korean War this week. Korean War is technically still going on. It's just a ceasefire.
Yeah.
We remember those who fought alongside the Korean soldiers during the war, those who came from 16 countries as the UN forces. Tens of thousands of them gave their precious lives for the peace and freedom in this country. Father, we pray that you would put your arms around their wives, sons, and daughters, and their children on our behalf. We pray for those who are traveling for their safety.
Amen.
Father, we are grateful for our church and all those who serve behind the scenes. Send us revival and growth, and provide for us and meet our needs. Father, we pray for our speaker this morning, the Reverend Tim Dilmuth. We ask that you would bless him and anoint him as he opens your word to us this morning. Let us not only be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. We also pray for his ministry, Voice of the Martyrs, Korea. Encourage them and provide for them as they strive to serve you through the ministry. We pray all this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we're going to continue our worship with tithes and offering. Usher, come please. Thank you.
thank you for keep bringing us to the sanctuary together this morning. As we come into the sanctuary, we didn't come empty-handed, but you brought your small gift as a token of our love. But Lord, count that our behavior, our coming, our prayer, and our music, our singing, all as together as a whole, and accept us. Even though we have some imperfect things in our life, but you love us, you accept us today, and forgive us, and have a joy with us this morning. We have many good friends in this congregation today. Some of them are traveling, some of them overseas, that they cannot come back, and some of them are somewhere in this country, in other churches. Bless all of them and unite them with us in today's service. Thank you for giving us financial strength every month so that we can bring you something every Sunday. Bless each one of us. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from Jeremiah in the Old Testament. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 1 through 19. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 14 through 19. Youngin Kim is going to read Jeremiah.
Shall we all rise with respect to the Word of God? Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 14. The Lord said to me, from the north, disaster will be poured out on all who live in the land. I am about to summon all the peoples of the northern kingdom, declares the Lord. Their kings will come and set up their thrones in the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem. They will come against all her surrounding walls and against all the towns of Judah. I will pronounce my judgments on my people because of their wickedness in forsaking me, in burning incense to other gods, and in worshiping what their hands have made. Get yourself ready. Stand up and say to them whatever I command you. Do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them. Today I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar and bronze wall to stand against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and the people of the land. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you. For I am with you, and will rescue you, declares the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Before I introduce the speaker this morning, I ask his wife Melissa to talk about what to do on those literature on the table there. They brought some literature.
Okay, I can just share them.
Yes.
Okay. So we brought just a few materials with us today. We have every month we produce a newsletter. We have both English and Korean newsletter, so it is free and you can take it with you today. So Korean, English, and if you would like to receive it monthly, you can sign up to receive it We also have the digital version, so if you don't want to get paper one in your mailbox, we can send you twice a month. We send out a digital like prayer update, and also has our newsletter, so you can get that one.
Mm-hmm.
And then we brought three books with us today. They're each 10,000 won each. Tortured for Christ is the story of our founder, Voice of the Martyrs founder, Pastor Richard Wolbrand, who was a pastor in Romania, and he was imprisoned for 14 years under the communists and the Nazis. So it is the story of how God was faithful to the Christians at that time under great persecution. So highly recommend this Tortured for Christ book. We have in English and Korean. And then These Are the Generations is the story of one family from North Korea. So our CEO, Pastor Foley, wrote this book with a North Korean family, and it is the story of how God has been so faithful in North Korea to preserve the Christians there, even under the great persecution. So really also highly recommend this. It's easy reading. And then this one is called Imprisoned with ISIS. And our sister VOM mission in the Czech Republic, their CEO went to Sudan a few years ago to visit our persecuted brothers and sisters in Sudan. And he was arrested by the Sudanese government, and he was in prison in Sudan with ISIS members, and he was almost killed by them. But it is the story of God's faithfulness in the Sudanese prison, and really, really just build your faith.
I suppose they are on your website.
They are on our website, and yes, and we
have
them.
Simon is from Germany. I'm curious. People, when they travel, they don't try to find a church to join the worship service. But Simon came in. You are a Christian, I suppose. Could you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Oh,
yes.
So I'm Simon. Nice to meet you all. I'm from Germany, from Munich. My mom is Catholic, my dad is Protestant, so I grew up in a Protestant church. I came on an exchange semester to Singapore. And after 2 weeks of being in Singapore, I had the point where I thought, like, wow, I'm meeting so many people, it's so nice, but somehow something is missing. And that was the point in Singapore where I looked for. At that point, it was only an online service, but after that, I connected to like a Christian community at my university. And since then, I feel like it's always so nice to see Christians everywhere on the world who are like connected to like the same Bible, the same belief. And if it works out, and here in Seoul, it worked again, but I found a church to go to. But I'm always very, very happy to see how Christians celebrate similarly, but also differently in other countries.
What will you do for next 2 weeks in Korea?
Thank you very much.
You will just travel?
Next week I'll not be in Seoul, but I hope that I find a church wherever I go.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much for joining us. And in front of Ambassador He, two wonderful ladies, and could you tell us? Yes.
Hello, we're from the USA, America. We also go to the same church as Mike and Katie.
With whom?
With Mike and Katie's
us. Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes, that's right. Thank you for joining us this morning. Appreciate it. Joshi, is your wife doing well in India?
Yes.
All right, good. Wonderful. Yongi is gone. Yongi is in the USA, and while she's gone, several members are performing her duties, and I appreciate what you're doing. Now, Pastor Tim Dilmuth is the discipleship pastor for Voice of the Martyrs Korea, VOM. He also oversees VOM Korea's China and Russia projects, as well as the communications department. Pastor Tim received a bachelor's degree from Zion Bible College and a Master of Divinity degree from Regent University. I suppose both of them are in the USA.
Yes.
Yes. He is an ordained pastor of the Evangelical Church of North America. Pastor Tim and his family, you see at least three of them. One is missing, but someday we'll see him. They live in Seoul, Korea, in Songdo. I'm very happy that he agreed to come and deliver a message. I am pretty sure that he has first-hand knowledge on the what's going on in the world in terms of Christian Christians receiving persecution or troubles. We always sit here and worship comfortably, sing painlessly, and we don't know what's going on. You know how many people are suffering because of their Christian faith. Maybe he will bring that message today, if not some other time. I hope to see him more in the future. Okay, Tim, all yours.
It's so good to be with you here today. I was surprised when we drove up to the building because I realized I have been here before. In fact, when I was here before, these chairs were filled with North Koreans. And so you never know who can sit in these chairs before you or who will sit in these chairs after you. That was, of course, pre-coronavirus time that these chairs were all filled with North Koreans. But when my family and I moved to Korea 7 years ago, we were often humbly reminded of the first missionaries that came to South Korea. We were reminded of the Allens and the Scrantons and the Appenzellers and the Underwoods. And we would often think how much easier missionaries have it today. You know, I can call my mother in a similar way. If I were in America, it's very easy to call her. Of course, plane flights are very expensive and coronavirus made it more difficult, but it's not too challenging for us to travel nowadays. But of course, when the first missionaries came to Korea, it was a much different story. And many of you, I'm sure, are also familiar with Robert Thomas, who is often known as the first Protestant missionary martyr in Korea. And so today, being with you at Seoul Union Church, I'm reminded of those first missionaries again and their sacrifice to the nation of Korea, their sacrifice to the Lord, and also, of course, the wonderful history of Seoul Union Church. But some of you may know, some of you may not know, that even before the first missionaries arrived in Korea, the Bible came to Korea. Did you know that? Missionary John Ross, who was a missionary in China, he commissioned the first translation of the Bible into Korean. And the interesting thing about the story of the first Bible was that he didn't translate the Bible according to Western standards. He didn't use professional translators or missionaries to translate the Bible. He used Korean merchants who were not Christian. In fact, they became Christian as they translated the Bible. And after the Bible was translated, he just did the New Testament. He sent the Bible into Korea. He sent approximately 15,000 copies of the Bible into Korea. So that when the first missionaries arrived in Korea, the Underwoods, the Appenzellers, they had some Koreans approach them about being baptized. And of course, that was strange to them, because how could people know about getting baptized, that the missionaries we just got here to Korea? But they had read the Bible, and they had read and understood the command to be baptized. So this is something that I think a lot about John Ross, missionary John Ross, and his missionary strategy of the Word of God being sufficient, the Word of God accomplishing the purposes of God. And that's what the Bible says, doesn't it? In Isaiah chapter 55, that God's Word always accomplishes its purpose. And the Word of God has done just that in Korea. The Word of God has accomplished its purpose, is still accomplishing its purpose. And we see that in the different nations that we work in. We work in over 70 countries around the world where Christians are persecuted. And specifically here in Korea, we do most of our work in North Korea, China, and many of the Russian language nations. And I think this is so clear, especially in the nation of North Korea. The Kim regime, you know, one of its main goals has been to destroy Christianity. And yet, Christians still exist in North Korea today. Our estimate, and not just our estimate, these are official numbers that many groups estimate, is that there are over 100,000 Christians in North Korea, in a country where the Kim family has tried to destroy Christianity. And the Christians in North Korea, we would say, are underground Christians. They are Christians without church buildings, Christians without pastors, even Christians without the full copy of God's Word. But the church, the underground church in North Korea, is built upon the foundation of the Word of God that was brought into that country through missionary John Ross and those Korean merchants. Let me ask you a question this morning. If I were to say or to ask you, where is Christianity growing faster, in South Korea or in North Korea? What would you say? I heard the right answer, the correct answer, in North Korea. So you know, in South Korea, Christianity has been on decline since 1980. But in North Korea, Christianity is growing. And in fact, we see this in almost all of the 70 nations around the world where Christians are persecuted. Do you know that Christianity is growing in China? Christianity, maybe the fastest growing Christian church in the world, is in Iran. And yet in America, Christianity has been on severe decline since the 2000s. In countries where Christians have nothing else to rely on except for the Word of God, Christianity is growing. So in places like North Korea, China, Iran, we see the Lord being faithful to perform His Word. In what appears to be the worst circumstances, we might consider them to be the hardest places to be a Christian. The church is growing, and God is fulfilling His Word. My wife mentioned Richard Wurmbrand, the founder, the original founder of Voice of the Martyrs, his book, Tortured for Christ. After he was released from prison, he started to travel the world and tell people about the Christians he was imprisoned with. But one of the things he said, this is very interesting, he said he never worries about Christians in closed countries, but he worries about Christians in places like Europe and America. And if Richard Wurmbrand were alive today, he would probably say he worries about Christians in South Korea. So what you won't hear from me today is how sad it is that Christians suffer. You won't hear that, because we're not trying to help them or to rescue them. Actually, what I found since being a part of this ministry is I need more of what they have. I need more of that simple dependence upon God and His Word. Now, Voice of the Martyrs was started before I joined. Voice of the Martyrs Korea was started about 20 years ago. So let me tell you a really interesting story about the beginning of our ministry. Our founders, Pastor and Dr. Foley, he's American, she's Korean. They were up near the North Korea border in China, and they met some North Korean underground Christians. And Pastor Foley said to them, "How can we pray for you?" And they said, "Pray for us, we pray for you." And Pastor Foley said, "Well, why would you pray for us? I'm an American. You know, we have everything we need. I have money. I can pull it out right now and give you money. What do you need?" And the North Koreans looked at him and said, "That's just the problem with you American Christians and you South Korean Christians. You rely on things like money and power, where all we have is God himself. We rely on God himself." So this morning, I want to talk to you, I want to look at persecuted Christians together today, but from the Word of God. We're going to look at the prophet Jeremiah, who was himself a persecuted follower of God. Now, I hope you were following along and reading a little bit when we read the scripture together today. But Jeremiah chapter 1 is a very interesting passage of scripture. Many of us know the good parts of Jeremiah chapter 1. I don't know if you remember, but in another verse, we didn't read it this morning, Jeremiah says something to the Lord like, "I am only a youth." And yet we know that God used this youth powerfully. In some of the verses that we read today, we see the Lord telling Jeremiah, "I will make you like an iron pillar, a bronze wall. They will fight against you, but not prevail." So it's very encouraging, right, when we read those verses. But just think about all of the other parts of those verses. I'll just say them to you, but feel free to follow along in your Bible if you have it. In verse 14, God tells Jeremiah, "Out of the north, disaster will come." In verse 16, God says, "I will declare my judgments against Judah." And then in verse 18, what we just said is that God said, "I will make you an iron pillar, a bronze wall." But listen to this: "Against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its people." And then God says in verse 19, "They will fight against you." Now, I don't know if you understand all of this, but this is really bad news for Jeremiah. So God is saying, "Jeremiah, disaster is coming for your people." So this is not another people. This is Jeremiah's people, the people of Judah. God is sending disaster to Jeremiah's people, and God says that he's going to use Jeremiah to share these words of disaster. And get this, they're not going to listen to you, Jeremiah. They're not going to like you, and they're going to fight against you. This was Jeremiah's call to ministry. Now, I remember when I was ordained a pastor, I was on a stage similar to this. I had many other pastors and church leaders laying their hands on me and praying for me. It was a very encouraging time. But Jeremiah chapter 1 is his call to ministry. And maybe we would say it's a terrible call to ministry. No encouraging words, no laying on of hands. The words from the Lord is, "Jeremiah, disaster is coming. And you're going to speak it, no one's going to listen, Jeremiah." And you know what? It came true. Jeremiah had an extremely difficult ministry. In Jeremiah chapter 20, I think that's a great example of the difficult ministry that he had. Because in Jeremiah chapter 20, verse 6, Jeremiah was beat up by a priest by the name of Pashur. So, you know, if I put myself in Jeremiah's shoes, I might think that Jeremiah might expect persecution from many of the people of the town, right? He knew that people would not like his message. But maybe Jeremiah expected to be accepted by the religious leaders. But here is a religious leader, the priest, beating up Jeremiah and putting him in stocks. The priest, the most religious man in all of Judah, doesn't even like Jeremiah. And two verses later, in verse 8, the people were saying to Jeremiah, they said, "You shall die." Those were the words to Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah did not die at that point, but this was the feeling towards the prophet Jeremiah. Nobody liked him. Even the religious leaders didn't like him. They beat him up. They put him in prison. Now, I think the worst part of the story of Jeremiah comes near the end of the book of Jeremiah, in Jeremiah chapter 43. So let me explain to you what has been happening. Jeremiah has been prophesying and telling the people that Babylon will come and destroy Jerusalem. And so that's what happens. Many people were kidnapped, taken away to Babylon. You may know the book of Daniel, the prophet Daniel. He was a contemporary of Jeremiah almost the same time. So Daniel and many of his friends were taken away to Babylon. But Jeremiah was left in the city. So there were some people that were allowed to stay in the city of Jerusalem. And most of the people that were left behind were maybe, not so rich. You know, Daniel came from a better family. Many of the people that were left were poor. And so Jeremiah was left with some of these people in the city of Jerusalem. And when that happened, Jeremiah really encouraged the people. He said, "Guys, God has not abandoned us. Let's look to the Lord. Let's pray. God can save us. It's not over yet." Jeremiah said, "But the one thing you shouldn't do is go to Egypt. Don't look for help from Egypt. They won't help you. We should only look to the Lord God." And so in Jeremiah 43, do you know what happens? Jeremiah is kidnapped and taken to Egypt. The people that are left in Jerusalem, they don't look to the Lord for help. They go to Egypt because they say, "You know what? I think Egypt can really help us out in this situation." And that's the last we hear from Jeremiah. So the one thing Jeremiah said not to do, don't go to Egypt. That's where Jeremiah's life ends, in Egypt, in the one place that he said not to go. This was Jeremiah's ministry. Now, I would encourage you, on your own time, look up Lamentations chapter 3. It's a fascinating chapter. This is where Jeremiah kind of complains to the Lord. And Jeremiah explains all of the hardships that he's received in his life. So listen to this. He attributes these hardships to the Lord. He says, "God, you did this to me." Jeremiah says, "You tired me out. You broke my bones. You attacked me. You put heavy chains on me." And then it gets really interesting. He says, "Lord, you are like a bear waiting to attack me." And this is really interesting. Jeremiah says, "Lord, it's like you give me rocks to chew on." Rocks to chew on. So Jeremiah shares all of the hardships that he's experienced in Lamentations chapter 3. And yet Jeremiah comes to the conclusion that God's love is so great. God's mercy is so great. Now, as Pastor Coe mentioned a few minutes ago, my daughter Emily just graduated from high school. So she's going to the U.S. and going to college. And she has a desire to work with animals. That's what she wants to do. So if I told Emily, I said, "You know, Emily, if you go into a field of working with animals, it's going to go horribly for you. The animals aren't going to like you. They're going to scratch you. They're going to do all kinds of nasty things to you. Your colleagues at work are not going to like you. In fact, you're going to end up getting fired. You're going to lose all of your money, Emily, and eventually you'll end up in jail." What do you think Emily would choose to do? Maybe she would choose to do a different job, right? Not go to college to study animals. I think that's what any wise person would do. But this is what happened to Jeremiah, isn't it? God told Jeremiah, "Hey, all these bad things are going to happen. Jeremiah had every reason to be afraid. He had every reason to run away from ministry. And yet, we know that Jeremiah didn't run away. We know that he was faithful to do what the Lord gave him to do. But you know, for us as Christians, did you know the promise of God for us is the same as it was for Jeremiah? John chapter 15, verse 20, Jesus told his disciples, listen to this. Jesus says, if they persecuted me, they will persecute you. The apostle Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, everyone who wants to live a godly life will be persecuted. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. It sounds funny to say, but this is our heritage as Christians. The world does not welcome our message. It does not like the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is not good news to the world. So if this is true, what can we do? Well, I think we can learn from persecuted Christians. We can learn from people like Jeremiah. We can learn from the Apostle Paul, who, you know, wrote many of the New Testament books while he was in prison. The book of Philippians, we call the book of joy, was written inside of a prison cell. We can learn from the persecuted Christians in the Bible, from the persecuted Christians that are all around us today. And so that's what I want to do from the book of Jeremiah is what does Jeremiah have to teach us today? Well, a few verses before our passage of Scripture. Our passage of Scripture started in verse 14. But if you look at verses 11 and 12 in Jeremiah chapter 1, we see something very interesting happening. God says to Jeremiah, what do you see? And Jeremiah says, I see an almond branch. And God says, yeah, that's right, Jeremiah. For I am watching over my word to perform it. Now, in English and Korean, it's a little bit hard to understand what's going on. But if you look at the original Hebrew, you see that the words almond branch and watching over are very similar sounding words. So this is almost like a word play because the words are so similar sounding. The almond tree is one of the first trees to bud. You see leaves coming out in the spring. So God is saying that his word is coming alive just like the almond tree comes alive in the spring. Just as the almond tree is sprouting flowers, leaves producing almonds, it's almost always a sure thing in the springtime. So the fulfillment of God's word is also a sure thing. Jeremiah says that God is watching over his word to perform it. Now, I don't know about you, but often when I think of God, I think of God sitting up in heaven, just kind of looking out over the earth. You know, almost like very passive. Maybe like you might sit down in your chair at home and flip through the TV channels. I think many people think of God like that. But Jeremiah gives us a very different picture of God. He said that God is actively watching over his word to perform it. In other words, listen to this. The promises of God, the fulfillment of those promises are a sure thing. If God says it would happen, then it will happen because God is watching over his word to perform it. So you see, when we think of the world today, God is not limited by any kind of political situation. God is not limited by any kind of government. So let me tell you what God does not say. God does not say, that Kim Jong-un is a big problem. If I could just get Kim Jong-un out of North Korea, I could really do something. North Korea. You know, I want to plant a lot of churches in North Korea. Just not possible with Kim Jong-un. If I could find a way to get him out of there, then man, we could really do some good work in North Korea. God doesn't say those kind of things because God's not limited by governments or world leaders. God is watching over his word to perform. And then remember, we said that the church is growing the fastest in places like North Korea, Afghanistan, Iran. You see, our problem today as Christians is we focus too much on what we can see, what we can hear, what we can feel. Instead, God is working in ways that often cannot be seen and cannot be heard and cannot be felt. Even in the book of Jeremiah, everything looked terrible. Everything looked terrible, and yet God was doing his work. So when we think of persecuted Christians, our first reaction is often to feel sorry for them because of what we see and what we feel. We feel like we can help them. Maybe they can learn from some of the things I learned in seminary. But God says something different. God says, I am at work and you can be a part. Not because God needs you, but because God is gracious and merciful and invites you to be a part of his work. God's promise in the book of Jeremiah is a powerful one. I am watching over my word to perform it. We know that the scriptures say that his word is powerful and living, sharper than any double-edged sword. We know that the Bible says that through God's word, we are equipped for every good work. You know, the Bible says that heaven and earth will pass away, but God's word will always remain. John chapter 1 teaches us that Jesus, in fact, is the word of God. And did you know that all promises in Scripture, including the book of Jeremiah, all promises of Scripture are fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ? All the promises of God are yes and amen in Jesus Christ. Through Christ's death, through his resurrection, through his ascension, the character of God has been revealed to us and the promises of God have been fulfilled. That's amazing, isn't it? All the promises of God have been fulfilled through Jesus Christ. North Korean underground Christians for four generations have practiced Christianity through nothing but the word of God alone. No pastors, no church buildings, no denominations. Sometimes they only know, in fact, a very small part of the Christian faith. So underground Christians in North Korea, when Kim Il-sung was consolidating power, they asked the question, how can we pass on our faith to future generations? So for example, this was planned by North Korean underground Christians. They said, let's make sure to memorize, because you know they couldn't keep papers, it was too dangerous. Let's make sure to memorize and pass on the Lord's Prayer, the Ten Commandments, the Apostles' Creed, and different stories of the Bible. So that's what they've done, and we meet North Korean underground Christians who have learned those things from generations before them. Ultimately, these North Korean underground Christians live on nothing but the word of God alone. And this is one of the things I think that is most important for us to learn in South Korea and in America, that our Christian faith is not built on buildings or exciting worship music or great pastors. We're free in Christ, not because of government regulations. We're free in Christ because of Christ's death and resurrection and forgiveness offered to us. One of our co-workers who Melissa mentioned, the book In Prison with ISIS, Peter Yasek, he was visiting underground Christians in Sudan, and as he was about to leave the country, they arrested him. They took his camera, his laptop, his cell phone, and he was accused of espionage, of spying. And he was threatened with a death sentence, but he eventually went to trial in Sudan and was found guilty and given the sentence of imprisonment for life. He only ended up spending 445 days in prison, but during those 445 days, he spent time in five different prisons. The first of those prisons was the most difficult because five of his cellmates were ISIS members. And do you remember, I forget how long ago, maybe 10 years ago, the 20 Egyptian Coptic Christians who were beheaded on the beach in Libya? There are some famous photos on the internet of 20 Christians in orange jumpsuits. And they were made to kneel down and they were beheaded for their Anyway, one of Peter's cellmates was one of the members of ISIS who did that work. He was called, his nickname was called Man of the Sword. Peter is from the Czech Republic. So they were very honest with Peter. They said, you know, if you were American, Peter, we would have killed you already. But that was the worst point in his prison experience. But later, he was moved to solitary confinement, and he was given a Bible. And so he began to read his Bible all the time for 3 months. He was able to read it over and over and over again. And then he was transferred to another prison that, believe it or not, had a Christian chapel. They had a Muslim mosque and a Christian chapel. And when he arrived, they said, Peter, you're preaching now because you had a Bible. So you preach. So he preached in that chapel. And one night in that prison, he had 14 Eritreans as his cellmates. Eritrea is a country right above Ethiopia in Africa. Eritrea is called the North Korea of Africa because the government idolizes the Kim family. So they imprison Christians. Anyway, these 14 Eritreans were not Christian. Peter shared the gospel with them. They became Christian that night, and then the next day they were sent somewhere else. And at that moment, Peter said he realized something very important. Up until that point, he had been wishing he could get out of prison. He's been wondering why God put him in prison. And at that point, he said, I realized that God sent me to this prison, that God sent those 14 Eritreans to hear the gospel. And he said he realized that God held the key to the prison. And no longer was he going to ask God to get out. He was going to faithfully serve in the prison that he was in. He realized that God's word is not bound. Even though he was bound as a criminal, God's word was not bound. And that's what the Apostle Paul said too. So you see, in the most difficult parts of the world, in Sudan, even in the prison cells with ISIS members, God is working through his word. God is active. God is in control. No matter the state of the government, God's word is never bound. And so that's why our ministry philosophy is never to think about what great things we can think of or do. Oh, like, oh, what should we do in North Korea? It's always to listen and find out what God is already doing in a particular country. So we can share more about this later. Feel free to ask us any questions. But for example, in China, you know that the Chinese government has banned children from going to church. And every year, the Chinese government controls get tighter and tighter. And so, in fact, even before coronavirus, it was very difficult for families to go to church in China. So Chinese underground church leaders asked us to do a Sunday school in a box, put together Christian materials, and send them to China so that families can worship together with the Bible, with Christian literature, with video players that can play movies about Jesus. And so that's what we did. We fulfilled their request. We sent 5,000 Sunday school boxes a few years ago. Last year, we sent 4,000 Sunday school boxes. That's also our ministry philosophy with North Korea. We learned from the underground North Korean church what things would be most helpful to them. So that's why we do radio broadcasting into North Korea, like FEBC. They asked us to send the gospel to North Korea through radio broadcasting. That's also why we do a missionary training school here in South Korea. We call it UU, Underground University. But it's training North Koreans to reach out to other North Koreans. And in fact, right now, one of the ways they're reaching out to other North Koreans is through retranslating that Bible I told you about in the beginning, the John Ross Bible. The John Ross Bible was originally translated by North Koreans, and it's very hard to read today, even for average Koreans, because the language is very old, and it's not written left to right, it's written up and down. But our North Korean students are retranslating the Gospel of Luke this year, the original John Ross Bible. So we hope to have that available for everyone towards the end of the year. But that's why we do these kind of ministry activities, because the Christians in these countries said, this would be helpful. Can you please do this with us? Martin Luther, who I'm sure you all know, one of the great reformers of the Protestant Christian faith, said this. Listen to this. This quote impacted me so much. He said, "What is Luther? The teaching is not mine." He said, "I wasn't crucified for anyone." He said, "How did I, poor, stinking bag of maggots that I am, come to the point where people call the children of Christ by my evil name?" Because they called them Lutherans. He said, "Why do they call them by my evil name?" Listen to this. Martin Luther said, "I simply taught, preached, and wrote God's word. Otherwise, I did nothing. I did nothing. The word of God did everything." Isn't that powerful? "I did nothing. The word of God did everything." Let me leave you with this short story. Before the coronavirus, we traveled to Ethiopia to meet with Eritrean refugees. And some of these were refugees, others were Eritreans that would go back and forth across the border. We met with one lady who, she and her husband were imprisoned for their faith in Eritrea. He was killed in the prison. She was not killed, but she was raped multiple times in the prison, so that when she was released from prison and came to Ethiopia, she found out she had HIV, AIDS. Now, in the Ethiopian Eritrean church, it's a shameful thing to have HIV. In other words, other Christians would look at her and say things like, "God is not happy with you. You're sinful. That's why you got HIV." So she hid this from everyone. She looked healthy. You know, she took medicine to keep her body healthy. When she would go to the clinic, though, she would put this over her head so no one could see that she was going to the clinic. So she was very embarrassed. She was very shameful. And so we read from Psalms 34 to her, which says, "I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame." So we read this to her, and then we had her read this aloud. And I don't know how many times we did this, maybe 10 times. We read it over and over again. And with each reading of the scripture, you could see the smile grow on her face a little more and a little more. And so we were speaking the word of God to each other. We were listening to the word of God. And it was like we could see that God's word was being fulfilled simply by speaking it and listening all together. Now, I'm not saying like it's like magic. I'm not saying, "Oh, just speak whatever and your speaking has power. Oh, faith." It's not like that kind of magic that you may hear in some churches, like the word of faith. But simply put, we believe that God's word is powerful. Amen. And one of the reasons we're here, the main reason we're here today, is to preach the word and to hear the word, because we understand that God is working through this. And so I saw that happen in the face of this lady as we spoke the word of God over and over and over again. Hebrews 13:3 tells us to remember our brothers and sisters who are in prison. So let me leave you this morning with possibly the best way to remember our persecuted brothers and sisters. The best way to remember our brothers and sisters who are in prison for the gospel is to live with complete dependence on the word of God. Is to live knowing without a shadow of a doubt that God is fulfilling his promises. That's what faith is, right? We can't see it. We don't understand it, but we know through the person of Jesus Christ, through his death and resurrection, that God is fulfilling his word, that God is present with us. And you know what? All of us will go through difficult times in our life. Maybe some of you may be persecuted for your faith in Jesus Christ. Other times it's just because we're human beings, right? We suffer from sickness. We lose friends and family members. So all of us will experience difficult times in our life. And I would challenge you this morning to cling to the Word of God. Even when it doesn't look like it, remember that God is present to us through His Word. May God add His blessing to His Word this morning.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for the powerful message. Today is, as Chang Su prayed, today is, yesterday actually, it was 72 years after the North Korean invasion to South Korea. If I had preached today, I would have done something on that subject. Next week, still I will expound on the Ten Commandments, and I will connect that to this commandment. So next week we have a guest speaker, and then I will preach. All right, let us stand and sing because He is. Now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the abundant love of our God, Yahweh the Almighty, and the leading and the holy communication and the protection of the Holy Spirit be upon us and upon our children, upon our church, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. thank you. Have a great week. Triumphant week.